and welcome to Prairie Pulse. Coming up a little bit later in the show, we'll tour a magnificent lighthouse in Lake of the Woods, Minnesota. But first, joining me right now, our guest is Bill Strusinski. Bill, thanks for joining us today.
You're welcome, John.
Well, Bill, you're joining us today. We're going to hear a lot about you and find out a lot, but you're here today to talk about a book you wrote, Care Under Fire. Before we get to that book, though, tell the folks a little bit about yourself and your background, maybe.
Okay. Well, I grew up in St. Paul, Minnesota. I went into the Army in 1967. I'm a graduate of Mankato State College, and I live currently in Scandia, Minnesota, with my wife, Kirsten. I've devoted my career since I got out of the military and out of college to public policy development, and I represent a lot of people's interests at the Minnesota legislature, actually. And I've been doing that for almost 50 years.
Yeah, you have. Full disclosure, of course, you do a lot of work for Minnesota Public Television Group, just for full disclosure there. You've done a lot of work in state government, but today we're here to talk about the book, Care Under Fire. Bill, why did you write this book?
Well, I wrote this book because I've always felt there was a need to tell the story that politicians need to understand the impact war has on individuals and on families and the impact of their decisions. Ken Burns went into that quite a bit in his series recently, but I've always felt that soldiers will always do the job that they're called upon to do, even if it's a difficult situation. But I want politicians to understand the full ramifications of their decision-making process. That was one of the reasons. The second reason, I thought it was therapeutic for me to do this, so that I'd have an opportunity to turn post-traumatic stress into post-traumatic strength, if you will. It helped me deal with a lot of issues that have been identified for several years, and that was helpful. And I wanted, also, I think that at this station in life, I'm surprised how much interest there really is in the Vietnam War, and there's a lot of veterans who served in that war, at home, retired after long careers and whatever they did, and raised a family, and now they've got time to think about what happened to them. And they're dealing with some more complex issues, the issues of traumatic stress that they haven't addressed before. And so we're actually finding, the VA's finding, that there's more and more post-traumatic stress amongst the retired soldiers, and they need help. We got to tell our stories to get them that you can survive all of this and find a friend if you can. So.
Mm-hmm. Well, with that said, why the title, Care Under Fire, and sort of maybe describe the first time you had to give Care Under Fire?
Okay. Well, Care Under Fire is interesting enough as an Army protocol for training medics and how to deal with stress and combat casualties while they're under fire. And so it appropriately fit the job that I had in Vietnam in the 60s. So I think that's why I called it Care Under Fire.
Yeah, but so who did you serve with? Because obviously you, and did you have training as a medic before you went in?
Good question, John. I had no training as a medic. And I served with the 1st Infantry Division, the Big Red One, if you will, pretty well-known division because of the hidden Normandy beach in World War II. But that's who I served with. And I served with the Blue Spader Regiment, 1st Battalion, 26th Infantry. And I was a grunt medic, Company A, was where I spent my year with them in Vietnam. Back in, it was 1967 to 68 when I was in Vietnam.
So. Mm-hmm. So what about your first experience in providing care under fire? You mentioned somewhere in there the first was the worst.
Yeah, I think the first was the worst was a situation where I was pretty new in country, and we were moving out to an ambush patrol. Now, you have to understand that in the Vietnam War, medics were embedded with the infantry for the first time. All the other wars, World War II, World War I, Korea, the medics were really close to the front, but not actually on patrol with the infantry. And in Vietnam, we actually went on patrol every day with the infantry. In fact, I pulled about 200 patrols in my time there, and 60 of those were at night on what's called ambush patrol. This particular night, we were moving into an ambush site, and the platoon leader decided to change the location, go a little further into enemy territory, past the village, knew there was quite a few soldiers, enemy soldiers in that area. Going past this village, we started receiving fire. In fact, the fellow next to me saw a machine gun pointed at us and said, "Hit it, Doc." Doc was our acronym that we call call the medics. And we both got down. He was right next to me, about the same distance you and I are now, John, maybe a little closer. And a machine gun burst hit right in front of us, threw dirt in my face and ricocheted over my head, but one of the ricochets caught him and went into his shoulder and into his body. And it was very tough. I ended up laying on top of him and gave him morphine because he kept wanting to get up and run away. He was hurt really bad, and he eventually died that night. And so how to deal with that stress the first time, had been killed in action under my watch, was very traumatic and very difficult. And so that was a very important situation to me, and then that kind of set the stage for a lot of things to follow. I felt pretty sad about losing him. In fact, had to have a platoon sergeant talk to me eventually, because I was moping around and not focusing, and he said, look, you just got to deal with this situation. This is the first one for you. You're going to have more. He says, just get over it or you're not going to be worth a damn to the rest of your soldiers. So suck it up and move forward. And that's what I did. And that advice stuck with me the rest of my life.
Wow. Well, you have a chapter in here about race relations in Vietnam. What lessons do you think society today might take away from your experiences with African-American soldiers?
Good question. The military hadn't been integrated that long at that particular point in time, and I was in the military in 1967 through 1969, and those were turbulent times back in our country, with a lot of civil unrest going on and a lot of difficulties in between the races, certainly. And those things were transparent in the military to some extent as well. But when I got to an infantry unit, I replaced, in my platoon, I started out as a platoon medic, I replaced the black medic, and who knew the soldiers well and what have you. And as tough as it was in those days, the blacks were uncertain as to whether they could trust a white medic. I had no idea that that would be an issue. It wasn't to me, but it certainly was to them. And so we learned, but we had each other's back. And the first casualty I dealt with was a white guy, and no problem, took care of him, did my thing. But the next casualty actually was a black guy, and the blacks were talking about it amongst themselves, and I was told that they were suspect of whether I would treat a black the same as I treated the white. A lot of these fellows were from the South, and times where life was difficult for them in a non-military manner. And I did. I took care of him. I went out to the point and brought him back and took care of his injuries and stuff and evacuated him. And later on, the black soldiers all appreciated that I did that, that I wouldn't treat them any differently. And I said, I've got your back. You've got mine. That's what it's all about. We all bleed red. That was important. So we always had nicknames for people. I was Doc or Polak, because Strusinski is difficult for people to say. Particularly if you haven't seen many Polaks in your life from the South, and you're from the South. In any event, they started calling me Solak after that, and that name stuck with me in the Army, and I liked it, I enjoyed it, but it really talked about the bond that existed between soldiers. We didn't look at each other's color of our skin. You had black sergeants, you had white sergeants. We just trusted each other, and we dug foxholes together, and we took care of each other, and that sacred bond is very important. And it always amazed me that society couldn't figure out how to get along. We got along in a combat zone, and I was there when Martin Luther King was assassinated, and we talked about it, the blacks and the whites, about who he was and what have you. So I just was really perplexed by the society when I got back to the United States, how divided we were as a country, and perhaps we still are. But that's what I learned, and I thought it was remarkable, and that bond exists to this day.
Well, from your descriptions of a family in the book, clearly family is important to you. Can you share the advice you got from your family before you joined the Army?
Yeah, happy to. It was pretty simple. First of all, my dad and many of my uncles served in World War II. I'm of that generation, a baby boomer, if you will. So it was not a big deal to me when I got drafted. I didn't think about going to Canada or anything else, just going in the service. But my dad, when he took me down to the armory to go in, take my physical and to leave for boot camp, he said, Bill, I want to tell you one thing. He says, first of all, when you're in the Army, just keep your mouth shut and do what you're told. That was the practical advice he gave me. And you know, it was remarkable. That was the best advice he could possibly give, because that's what I did. And I survived the Army just fine and all those protocols.
Well, you mentioned already that medics are unique and special people in units. Can you expand more on that? And just because you're the doc, but...
Yeah, it was really interesting to me. I was 20 years old, and I turned 21 in Vietnam. But I was 20 when I got there. And obviously we took care of soldiers, their everyday maladies, so I could certify them to go out on patrol today. And took care of them when they got injured. I was right there with them. We'd go on patrols with as few as 10 people. And sometimes we had casualties at night, got in a firefight. But I also carried an M16, and I fired two if I needed to. They really relied on the medics and trusted us for that emergency health care immediately after upon getting injured. But it was sort of like interesting. People started bringing problems to me, you know, like I was the chaplain. There was no chaplain in the field. And I felt like I was a jungle therapist, if you will. People would talk to me. They got a Dear John letter from home and things. And I was giving marital advice to guys, and I was 20 years old. And frankly, I hadn't even had sexual relations myself at that point. But as you can tell, I'm a talker, and I listened to them, and I told them what they needed. They felt much more comfortable talking to me than they did the first sergeant. So that's we were all thanks to all those guys, and that bond solidified during those conversations.
Mm-hmm. Now let's go back. Your journey to writing this book. I understand I was told that it started with a speech you gave to emergency health care providers. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah. As you know, I've been around the Capitol for a number of years in public policy and government affairs. But I was asked by the Minnesota Ambulance Association to give a speech, be their keynote speaker one time. And I thought they wanted to talk about the legislative process. And they said, no. We heard you were a medic in Vietnam, a combat medic, and we'd like to hear your story. Well, I thought about that for a couple of weeks before I gave an answer, and I said, well, if anybody would understand what I went through, it would be those people, the EMS. So it was their Stars of Life banquet where they actually give out awards to all the EMTs and medics and paramedics that were throughout the year. And I gave that speech and talked about it because I knew they knew how to make the call under fire, how to deal with stress. You're the person on the job that everybody's looking for you to solve that problem. That's a lot of pressure. And you're dealing with life and death situations. And so I gave my speech. I got a standing ovation. I was very humbled by that. And everybody shouted, welcome home. And that felt really special to me, and it really did. And I'm glad I did it. And that was an incentive for me, since I had written a speech, to just continue telling my stories.
Bill, when you returned from Vietnam, how did your experiences there influence sort of the decisions you made throughout your life? You mentioned a little bit about it, but...
Yeah, there were a couple of things. First of all, one time, we were in Vietnam, we were out in the field for 119 days, and they called the entire brigade out of the field from our 1st Division and brought us in out of the field to a base camp to pack our equipment and get up on the tarmac, which is the runway. And we sat in that tarmac all night long, not knowing why. We were just, the whole brigade was up there. And the next morning, we stood down and went back out in the field again. And I asked the first sergeant, what was that all about? And he said, well, they captured some ship called the Pueblo, took it from the Navy, and it's in North Korean harbor. And we're getting ready to move all of you guys into North Korea for a combat operation. I'm like, whoa, who's making these decisions? And so I was perplexed by that, certainly. And I went to Japan in R&R, and I looked up an old friend of mine who was an Air Force controller, as it turns out, and I told him my story. And he says, well, let me tell you my story. He said, I was in the tower that day, and he said, we knew the Pueblo was a spy ship, and we knew they were in international waters, but the North Koreans came out with their gunboats to seize it. We had airplanes over the Pueblo, but they were all loaded with nuclear bombs. Nobody had a conventional 500-pound bomb amongst them. We brought them all back, rearmed them, and sent them back out with conventional bombs instead of tactical nuclear bombs. And I said, who's making these decisions? That was really overwhelming to me, and that was one of them. And the other one was that the government just couldn't agree to the shape of the conference table. We thought there was going to be peace discussions, and they couldn't agree to the conference table shape. And so That was very frustrating to all of us who were hoping to go home right away. Hey, peace talks broke out. So I decided at that point that I wanted to get involved in government and public policy. I made that decision in Vietnam. I came back and finished my, I had 2 years of college before I went in the service, and I finished it with a degree in political science and got involved in politics and government. I spent many years in state government and then formed my own governmental affairs firm so that I could still be involved with public policy. And I remember when I made that decision back in Vietnam in 1968.
Yeah. You also mentioned about bringing home lessons and applying them, as you're just talking about. But how about decisions and how you react to various situations? Can you tell us about those lessons and the meaning to you?
Yeah, you know, what's really interesting to me is that the first time you experience combat, it's hard to describe to people, and they can hardly prepare you for your training for that situation. My training was only 10 weeks as a medic. And so now you're in a combat situation and the adrenaline's rushing and you got it, and somebody hollers the word medic. Well, that's when I had to get up from my secure position and go to that person and render care under fire. I was smart. I always took the M60 machine gun operator with me, and he would lay down fire as I took care of business. But eventually you learn on-the-job training. Again, in 10 weeks, you can't train people for that circumstance. But you eventually learn how to keep your adrenaline under control, and you learn how to take care of business as you're supposed to and move forward. Now, and you tend to stay relaxed. You don't panic anymore at this point after some further experiences. Now, when you come back, I've never met a problem that I didn't think I could solve. I've always stayed calm. I've never let things get to me in my professional life or in family life. You just stay calm under fire. And you realize that you can handle this. You know, you have that inner confidence. And I was blessed, perhaps, to have learned that lesson in Vietnam that I applied the rest of my life. And I encourage a lot of people, and young people particularly, to take advantage of those experiences.
In your efforts as a lobbyist, you actually worked on getting money for public television documentaries in Minnesota about Vietnam. You know, how did the fundraising work help shape your decision maybe to tell your story?
Well, I worked with the Minnesota Public Television Association, and we certainly had an initiative called Minnesota Remembers Vietnam in concert and companionship with the Ken Burns series that aired a couple of years ago. But it required some legislative funding to get started. So I was the lead lobbyist in that effort, and I did a lot of presentations before committees, and I started telling my story to legislative committees and realized that there was just genuine interest in there, interest that there hadn't been for years, that they really wanted to hear about Vietnam and individual stories. So I went through that process. Our efforts were successful, and then I worked with public television during that next year to provide some insights and to gather some folks together to talk more about their experiences. So. That was another catalyst that was really important for me to get the word out and to talk about my story.
Well, Bill, what's the most important lesson or idea that you hope people would take away from reading this book?
Well, I think the most important lesson to learn is that we're all resilient. And even at 18 or 19 or 20 years old, 19 was the average age of a soldier in Vietnam, they're resilient, and they can do more than they think they can. There's no turning back. You can do that. And I think that I advise folks that you really can turn adversity into something positive with the rest of your life. These are really important lessons, and young people should know that it's not hopeless. There's a lot of opportunity out there, and your chance to prove yourself was special in my case.
Yeah. What do you think was the most misunderstood part of the soldier's Vietnam experience then? And then, of course, what do you think the most misunderstood part is today?
Well, I think they're the same, basically. People, when we came back from Vietnam, the protests were in full force. They were throwing eggs at the bus. I had people spit in my face like a lot of soldiers did because we wore uniforms. People were really upset. They weren't upset with the soldiers. We were merely an instrument of our government policy. And so they took out their anger on the soldiers when really they needed to direct their attention to the politicians in Washington, D.C., who sent us there in the first place, made those decisions. And that was wrong. We were just doing what we were asked to do for our country. We're all true patriots in any event, but we just did that. Now, it's interesting. I have had a number of reviews and a number of letters that I received from people who said they were protesters back in the 60s, and I was one of those people who spit at soldiers. But I really regret that part of my life. I now realize, reading your book, that it wasn't, you were just doing what you were asked to do on behalf of all of us, our country. It wasn't your fault you were there. And so we had our anger was misplaced. And I've changed my attitude about that, and I regret having that, and I apologize to you at least for my actions as a young person. So I thought it was remarkable.
Yeah. Well, Bill, this question's been asked over the years, but your opinion, your thoughts, was the Vietnam War a mistake?
I suspect ultimately, as Ken Burns disclosed in his interviews, that it was long-term. It probably was not the best strategy, but how do you know when things start out, when conflicts, when political decision-making occurs? So it wasn't a mistake to those of us who were there. It was very real, and it was a war. The 1st Division I was with lost more soldiers in Vietnam in 5 years than they did in World War II. Just amazing, because there was always so many different firefights. The average soldier was in about 200 firefights in a year's time if you were with infantry. We learned. The unfortunate thing is we learned, and we kind of figured it out when we were there, that this is an unwinnable war, the way they're taking it, the direction they're taking it, and it's not fair to the soldiers and their families and others to follow, that this is the route we have to pursue. So I think from that perspective, probably it was a mistake. But we all learned a lot, hopefully, from those experiences, and we certainly did as individual soldiers in our commitments to our lives. But I have to share with you one quick thing, is that we were told at the time, and here's how it ties together. We were told at the time I had to give 2 years to the Army. That was a lie. I've given the Army over 55 years of my life. These, you develop situations and you think about things that you can't escape you. They're with you every day, and I think about them every day. So it's important to understand resilience and how to deal with all of that stuff.
And you talk about that. Of course, a lot has been written, a lot's been talked about the trauma of experiencing combat and post-traumatic stress. You know, how did you deal with this trauma?
Another good question. I think I was certainly an introvert, and I was very secluded when I came back from Vietnam. But when I got back on college life, you start to reach out to others to make social connections. And I joined the Vets Club at Mankato State. Early on, we had our band of brothers, which replicated what we had in the service. And we stick together over all these years. I still have breakfast every Saturday with people I went to college with from that Vets Club. That enabled all of us to deal with those situations moving forward. Mm-hmm. And I think people just, if you're having issues, find somebody you can talk to about them. And I had that opportunity.
Bill, if you could talk to the young man that we meet in the sort of the beginning of the book, what advice would you give him?
I would say just keep your head down, first of all, and answer the call. And trust your friends, trust your buddies, trust your brothers, and things will work out just fine. At the end of the day, they did for me, and I've been able to deal with all these other issues the rest of my life. And again, turning post-traumatic stress into post-traumatic strength. And I love the impact it's had on my life as a public policy person.
Mm-hmm. What's been the reaction to the book so far, and how did you get it published?
Well, it's the reaction's been very overwhelming, and I'm really surprised. There's a lot of renewed interest in what happened with respect to the Vietnam War. I think because people didn't want to talk about it for so many years, they all felt guilty about a lot of things, perhaps. And we all felt the soldiers frustrated about the way things were going. So it is. I'm sorry, I just.
All right. How did you get it published?
Oh, actually, yes, thank you. I looked at the self-publishing, but that was too complex to me. This is a new field for me. I've never written a book before. And so I did approach a publisher, and we talked about it. Calumet Editions is my publisher. And they took and helped edit the final document, and then we published it and made it available through a variety of sources.
Well, with that said, if people are interested, would like to get a copy of the book, where can they go?
The easiest thing is to go to my website, which is called careunderfire.us, all one word, careunderfire.us. And there's more definition, more description of the book and an opportunity to purchase it there, which will take you to a link at Amazon where it's available.
All right. Well, Bill, we're out of time. Thanks for joining us today.
Okay. Thank you for having me.
Stay tuned for more. Built primarily for astronomy, the Flag Island Lighthouse in Lake of the Woods is a lake home unlike any other. Constructed on solid granite and standing 50 feet tall, it's commonly mistaken for an actual lighthouse. Owner Joe Lauren gives us a tour of his unique lake haven.
A lot of people think it's a public lighthouse. I do have a lot of visitors that come by and say, could we take a look? And for the most part, if we're around and we're not busy, we'll let people take a look. When I first found land on the northwest angle, I liked Flag Island, and I was big into astronomy. As the different trees would grow, I'd have trouble looking with all the trees in the way at the stars and stuff in the evening. So I thought I was going to build a big tall observatory. And I thought, you know, the neighbors probably won't like my tall observatory. So I thought I'll do something nautical and created a four-story lighthouse. The bottom of it is 25 by 25 and the top of it is 17 by 17 and it's 50 feet tall. We made it out of timber frame. To build out there, you have to haul the material, and you really can't haul 70,000 pounds of timber frame in the summer. It's really hard and it's difficult. So in the winter, we had great ice. So we actually had a semi deliver the wood to the shoreline of Young's Bay. And the plan was we would hook a cheap semi up in case we had problems on the ice road. We wouldn't have an expensive semi hooked up to the load. Unfortunately, the Texas truck driver who delivered the load said if we wanted the material, he wanted to deliver it because he watched ice road truckers and he thought it would be a great experience for him to drive 6 miles of ice road. So after trying to talk him out of possibly sacrificing his expensive semi, he insisted on delivering the load. So he came out there 12 miles an hour, followed me by snowmobile. We delivered it, everything went fine. And he was just ecstatic to be an ice road trucker. Not only did we have a semi come across, but also we needed a crane. It was pretty interesting to get a crane over the ice, up the road, up our trail, and then onto our flat rock. And right before the construction started, the crane operator said, I need this built up 3 feet. So he needed 3 feet of fill to be put in an area in winter. So it was, so many different challenges you had to pull something like that off, but it was, everyone worked together to get it done. The uniqueness is the timber frames. So each corner is 12 by 12 timbers. And it was interesting, a person in Belgium actually designed it. As you look, you'll see no fasteners. Everything's kind of tongue and groove, old artistry, workmanship, no fasteners. There's four stories. And the first story is like the living room. Second story is sleeping room. There's a bathroom. And then since space is at a premium, we have a washer and dryer. That's all the same unit. It washes and dries. And then the third floor is the floor where I do my app work. So I have computers there. I have all old maps. And then since the third floor is 17 feet tall, we have a rock climbing wall. The rock wall is interesting because it's not vertical. Since the building comes inward, the rock wall comes back on you. So it's a little bit more difficult to climb. The top floor is the lantern. It's kind of the observation area. We have an outer walkway deck and we have the light up there. The top floor is kind of just more if you like to read a book or you'd like to just sit back and relax and watch the boats go by or birds go by. Being it's on a 20-foot rock, the views are pretty incredible.
Well, that's all we have on Prairie Pulse this week. And as always, thanks for watching.
funded by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund, with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4th, 2008. And by the members of Prairie Public.